Well, on behalf of Chris, I want to thank you all for attending today in this part of our celebration of Stravinsky's centennial here at the U of M. And also, that is, we do want to remind you of the Marinsky Orchestra performance on this Saturday. You can check with UMS for tickets. And also, before I introduce our speaker today, I wanted to mention a few other events here at CREAS that we'd love to have you attend. First of all, tomorrow in this space at 4 p.m., we have Catherine Stoner joining us. She's from Stanford University, and she'll be speaking on how to undermine democracy, politics, and Putin's Russia. This is part of a special initiative that CREAS and the Weiser Center for Emerging Democracies are sponsoring, looking at pluralism in politics and culture. And also next week's CREAS Noon Lecture is our Rackham Centennial Lecture as well. Cynthia Buckley from the University of Illinois is joining us, and she will be talking about unregistered migration into the Russian Federation. So we hope you can join us for those, as well as we have many other flyers and pieces of information for you. So without further ado, I will introduce Kristen Matias Mecca, who is a distinguished faculty member here at U of M, as well as an active performer and research scholar in the area of dance music studies. And he's a native of Los Angeles, who has earned degrees in harpsichord and early music performance, as well as a veteran of the Interlaken Arts Academy before he came here to U of M. And he's also composed a number of works. And today, he will be talking to us about Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. So welcome, Christian.
Thank you, Nicole. Thank you all for coming today. You've just seen the conclusion of the Nijinsky choreography to the Rite of Spring. So now that we've seen the Nijinsky choreography for Le Sacre du Printemps, we should be able to agree that this ballet is in fact not lost, but is healthy enough to exist on YouTube, which, as we know, is a barometer of one's perpetual existence. So I don't know what we're all doing here. Who's buying lunch? So why is it here that we're here to discuss a lost ballet that we've just experienced on video? Some of us in the audience may remember that in the early 1980s, there existed on cable arts channels that actually presented arts programming. Opera, dance concerts, orchestra concerts, gallery previews, etc. There were no housewives, real or imagined or otherwise, ice road truckers, cook-offs, etc., but arts programs with minimal input from talking heads, MCs, etc. One evening in the early 1980s, I fired up my 6-inch color television, state-of-the-art for the time. The variety of unit where the accompanying hardware needed to run the unit added an additional 10 pounds to the miniature color screen. And I saw what appeared to be a dance program. I recognized the music was Igor Stravinsky's Le Sacre du Printemps, and the figures on the screen were, as I found out on the closing credits, members of the Pina Bausch Dance Company. Even with the television's tiny monophonic speakers and the dimly lit stage on the video, I could make out a corps of dancers in minimal clothing, something more akin to sleepwear, throwing themselves across the stage, rolling in dirt, possessed as if controlled by some unseen emotional creature. I entered the program during what I recognized as the second movement of the work, The Augurs of Spring. I gazed into the screen with all the focused concentration one might use with the manner of viewfinder one comes across on a pier or a scenic lookout. And I was transfixed by this mysterious montage of visions that purported to be a dance. At this time, my exposure to dance would only include ballet, as modern dance was still around in an upcoming corner. I didn't realize at the time, though, that this moment was that unforeseen corner, and it had arrived. And this was my first introduction to the dance, Le Sacre du Printemps. So let's watch a clip from the Pina Bausch choreography. We'll get rid of Arthur Murray Dayton, Ohio, to avoid any further confusion. I know, cruel to cut off before the top 40 single of the piece comes on, but there we go. When I first proposed this topic, the following question was posed to me. Are you trying to be clever or trying to address an important artistic cultural experience while playing the tragic role of the hip audience outreach educator, a role that I absolutely loathe? Or better yet, are you simply trying to set up a failing proposition? In truth, none of these are correct, but at the core of today's discussion is the now century-old fascination with Igor Stravinsky's Le Sacre du Printemps. Today I will discuss issues that involve both the movement and the music, and various co-opted claims that may cause us to misunderstand this work, thereby causing us to lose the ballet. I will also frame Le Sacre alongside other ballets composed by Stravinsky, Tchaikovsky, and Debussy to show how performance practices in both dance and music lead us to see ballets as something quite different than what they really are. So I'll ask, how can a ballet with over 200 different choreographic treatments and over 100 audio recordings be a lost ballet? Were I to play an excerpt from a recording of Sacre, many of us in the room could identify the music on the recording as Sacre, and others might refer to this as the ballet. In doing so, we are only identifying the musical score to a presumed ballet, even if we've not seen the kinesthetic or movement component of the dance. And the music we're listening to identify such is not the score, nor is it the work, but it is an electronic realization or capture of the work that serves only as one form of the document. So I'll address various factors that can mislead us into thinking that what we know as a ballet and what we look at as components that go into the creation and preservation of the ballet, and how these fragile structures can be compromised throughout the span of their performance life. In order to discuss the issues of lost dances, we need to move beyond the ever-favorite issue of the riot that is said to have occurred on the opening night and take into account a series of factors that relate both to programming and personality. A fortnight prior to Sacre's premiere on 29 May 1913 at the newly opened Théâtre des Champs-Élysées, the Ballet Russe premiered another Nijinsky work, Je. The score for this ballet was a commission from Claude Debussy, and it is one of the richest and most luscious of his works. Nijinsky had already created a minor scandal with his choreography to Debussy's Prélude l'après-midi d'enfant that premiered exactly 1 year prior to Sacre on 29 May 1912. The music for Fawn was nearly two decades old by the time Nijinsky came to it, so Diaghilev sought to pair Nijinsky with a new score from Debussy, which resulted in the commission for Je. When we consider the scandal that surrounded Fawn, we shouldn't be surprised that Nijinsky proposed Je as a dance for three men engaged in a ménage à trois. Calmer minds prevailed, and a more traditional pairing of two women with one man involved in a game of tennis outlined the theme of Nijinsky's newest work. In Debussy's letters, one can sense a bemused and impatient tone in his interactions with Diaghilev and Nijinsky. On Je, he writes to his publisher, Jacques Durand, quote, "It's hard to get it right because the music has to convey a rather risque situation, even though, in a ballet, immorality passes through the ballerina's legs and ends in a pirouette," end quote. To his friend Robert Godet, he writes about Nijinsky's choreography for Je. Quote, "The production of Je, in which Nijinsky's perverse genius applied itself to a special brand of mathematics. The man adds up demi-semi-quavers with his feet, checks the results with his arms, and then suddenly struck with paralysis all down one side, glares at the music as it goes past. I gather it's called a stylization of gesture. It's awful, Dalcrozian even, and I consider Monsieur Dalcroz one of music's worst enemies." So I thought I'd play an example of a Dalcroze exercise, and you'll see some of what Debussy is actually getting on about. This comes from the 1950s, a class directed by a student who was a student of Dalcroze.
Four.
This example bears more than a passing resemblance to any number of modern classes I've played, so my post-traumatic stress may just return upon viewing that. But I would like us to look at two excerpts from Je, including archival film of Tamara Karasavina, one of the original trio who premiered the work, and as well as a clip of Nijinsky, with a modern musical score superimposed. We don't know if this is the correct part of the musical score that's superimposed, but it does give us a sense of what the music was supposed to be with this movement. Nijinsky's use of the upper body, in particular the folded angles on the arms, bear more than a passing similarity to the gestural language we saw in the first clip of Sacre. This is Karasavina. Note the tilted head, stretching of the arms, and the way they're pulled back into the body, just as they had done in Sacre. If you had two masterpieces to create in 2 weeks, I'm sure you'd borrow material as well. Excuse me, didn't want to get there. This ballet, like Le Sacre du Printemps, that premiered 2 weeks later, was truly lost in that it disappeared from the Ballet Russe repertory soon after its premiere. Both ballets were restored by Millicent Hodson and were brought back to the stage in the 1980s by the Joffrey Ballet. You can read about the reconstruction of both Je and Sacre in Hodson's books, Nijinsky's Crime Against Grace, reconstruction score of the original choreography for Le Sacre du Printemps, and Nijinsky's Bloomsbury Ballet, reconstruction of dance and design for Je. Both titles are invaluable resources that allow the reader to enter the process and the various methodological approaches used by Hodson in reconstructing these ballets. In the case of Sacre, Hodson had contributions from Marie Rambert, Nijinsky's assistant and ballet mistress for the work. Rambert's long-considered lost written notes, and her, in addition to her personal memories, enabled Hodson to gather more choreographic content of the ballet than had been thought to be possible. But in no way can we assume that what was lost becomes wholly found through these processes. One valuable resource we have in helping us to understand there is not just one, but many Sacres, is the Roehampton-Stravinsky database. In this database, there are listings for over 204 different choreographies to the score for Le Sacre du Printemps, using both the orchestral and the piano versions. This shows that while we acknowledge one musical work as Sacre, we have to acknowledge multiple choreographic versions of these works. The Ballet of Sacre is perhaps second only to the Nutcracker, the most familiar and recognizable ballet in the repertory. Like the Nutcracker, it has been put to numerous choreographic settings, with over 200 choreographers having put their imprint upon the work. The score has been tackled by a range of choreographers that include Leonid Massine, whose official Ballet Russe version superseded the Nijinsky choreography beginning in 1921 and served as a basis for many others that followed. And it also used the same Nicholas Rorick sets and designs that were in the Nijinsky. Other choreographers include Agnes DeMille, Lester Horton, Mary Wigman, Maurice Béjart, Kenneth McMillan, Paul Taylor, Martha Graham, Mats Ek, Angeline Prelokash, Richard Alston, Doug Verone, and Alonzo King, and that's only a handful of the 200. So let us begin with the issues that relate to a ballet's musical content. I'll admit that among practitioners in the dance field, there exists a perpetual complaint that music is always given priority over the dance. What it means to give preference to, I'm never quite sure, because no one else has offered a more effective solution with which to initiate this discussion. I believe music is often left out of the dialogue in regards to notation, preservation, and legacy. It becomes by default the white elephant in the room when it should be seen as the crucial component of the whole, instead of an afterthought in the process. Also, as a musician and dance music specialist, it is my position that music can provide a better entry point for this discussion, as this field has either developed or adopted a deeper level of critical analyses than has the dance field. In the canon of the orchestral, Western orchestral repertoire, there exist a number of works composed specifically for use in dance, and an equal, if not greater, body of works that, if not initially intended for dance, have been used in choreography. Works originally composed for dance require a different set of approaches to analyses than do those works taken from the orchestral repertory for use. And while not generally understood by dancers or musicians, we have to consider that these works originate from very different processes. In the case of works composed for dance, the musician must, when they perform or direct these works, consider the function or role of choreographic gesture and the intention of action. Excuse me. Musical gestures respond to and communicate with choreographic gesture, regardless of whether the choreographer and composer collaborated with that intention. But as both musician and choreographer are reliant upon each other in the gestation of the work, we have to consider the completed work as a whole, constructed of two independent parts. Orchestral suites from Swan Lake, The Nutcracker, and Sleeping Beauty are widely known to concert audiences, as are a number of works by Igor Stravinsky, such as The Firebird, Petrushka, and of course, The Rite of Spring. Works composed by Mio, Prokofiev, Khachaturian, Shostakovich, and Copland, though originally composed in response to choreographic commissions, have also found their way into the orchestral concert repertory, and in some cases, the film score soundtrack repertory. As a result, the lines that help us define the origins and intentions of these works are often unclear or simply forgotten. The displacement created when a musical score is separated from its other half, in this case, the choreography, is a natural process when we consider that the relative ease and portability of presentation available to musical ensembles. It is not unexpected to accept that a work designed as one half of a single unit could be detached from its initial partnership to exist as a self-sufficient work, though this only benefits the musical end of the whole and not the choreographic end. The continued existence of a musical work long beyond that of the original choreographic work, such as the Nijinsky choreography, for which it was created, allows us to preference and mistakenly consider the score as the point of origination for a creative work. This becomes especially problematic when the original choreographic content is lost, obscured, or superseded by new choreographies to the score. Where we acknowledge only one musical score for The Nutcracker, or Romeo and Juliet, Sleeping Beauty, The Firebird, Le Sacre, we have a duty to recognize multiple versions for any of these ballets. But I believe that in these multiple settings, this is where the ballet also becomes easily lost. So we can acknowledge that there is more than one Sacre, but how is a dance preserved, archived, and passed on to succeeding generations? Since dance is conveyed primarily as an oral tradition, significant challenges arise when attempting to determine what constitutes a particular dance. Dance exists in the moment it is performed and ceases to exist upon its conclusion. Once a performance is concluded, all we are left with is the memory of the work, both ours and that of the performers and other audience members. We cannot revisit that experience without the complete reiteration or performance of the work. Memory, both singular and collective, is a relatively harmless tool in dance until that time when the choreographer passes on. Without the active participation of the choreographer, all that may remain when a dance is to be presented again is the memory. Let us address the issue or concept of the document as it relates to theater, music, and dance. Where in music or theater we have printed materials that enable us to experience a particular work on repeated occasions, both theater and music can be documented using languages that are seen as necessary to allow for the repeated interactions with a work. This doesn't imply that it's necessary for one to be able to read the particular language in order to experience a literary or theatrical work, since they can experience the written narrative if read by a third party. Assuming this party reads the text as it's presented on the paper, the listener can still fully experience the narrative and can interpret the work through their own imagination and emotional framework. In music, there exists a similar parallel in that trained musicians can read a notated score of a work and perform it, either as a soloist or in an ensemble. The listener experiences this rendering of the piece and can experience the creative work without the need to read or understand the particular language used by the composer to convey musical ideas to the musician or the performer. The musician, whether in Tashkent, Buenos Aires, Omaha, or Ho Chi Minh City, will read the musical score in a similar way and understand the meaning of the symbols used by the composer to convey these ideas. We also accept within certain parameters that a work documented in one language can be translated into other languages that open the work to audiences beyond those who share the native language of the author or composer. In music, we don't so much translate a work into another language, but we reshape the work for, let's say, another dialect. A particular work can be arranged or rescored for musical forces quite different from those intended by the composer. In music, we may choose to consider the printed text as the work, but can also consider it as a representation of the work. In the canon of Western music, there remain countless pieces that we consider as being lost because we simply do not have a printed score or manuscript of the work, and therefore we cannot play or present the music in any effective manner. Even with documentation that work X did at one point exist, it will remain lost if we cannot reference some manner of written documentation that allows us to perform the work in an effective manner. Though we consider other media as documents, such as audio recordings, we always return to the printed document as the primary source that enables us to interact with the work. In dance, this becomes a more difficult prospect as no single form of document is accepted across the field. Though symbol and motif-based languages have been used in dance for over 200 years, no one model has been accepted as a common language. In literature and music, the creator, whether author or composer, is responsible for the documentation of their work in print. But in dance, the choreographer is seldom, if ever, skilled in any form of notation, thereby requiring a third party or a notator to score or inscribe the work into print. This separation of creator from one who documents the creative work contributes to the challenges faced by those who support the use of dance notation, and that it disadvantages both the process and the value of this form of documentation. Again, the differences that exist between literature and music compared with dance widen even more. Once a writer or a composer presents their work in print, the person who handles the printed document has direct access, provided they possess the skill to read the particular language, to this work, and it serves as the next step in the creative process. Excuse me for that. I figured it was better than having 12 small coughs in the midst of this. Music theorist and feminist scholar Suzanne Cusick provides an argument that reinforces my own understanding of the ways in which music truly functions. She states, quote, "Music does not exist until bodies make it and or receive it. The score is not the work to a performer, nor is the score the sound of the work. The work includes the performer's mobilizing of previously studied skills so as to embody or to make real, to make sounding, a set of relationships that are partly relationship that are only partly relationships among sounds." We can also apply this theory to literature in stating that the text does not exist until a reader chooses to receive it. Cusick's theory relieves the printed score, the text, from the responsibility of serving as the work, and instead assigns it to a role of an intermediary for the reader, musician, or audience member. Cusick's theory cannot be easily translated for dance, since the oral tradition, which is favored in dance, is favored over the written text. Dance gives preference to memory-based oral traditions in preserving and passing dances on to succeeding generations. When a repetiteur is faced with a work that has already been created, he or she will initiate and direct the process to bring the dance back into the performance setting. A repetiteur's work can be described in one of three ways: as a reconstruction, a restaging, a revival, or actually, excuse me, a fourth way, a reimagining of the work. The restaging and revival are the least problematic processes of those listed, as in both cases, the dance may have been in the repertory on a semi-regular basis, or at least has a familiar presence in the repertory of one or more companies. A reconstruction involves the staging of a dance that has been long out of the repertory and may require the input of multiple parties, such as a historian or archivist, who works with the repetiteur to complete the work. This latter form can be used to describe Hodson's process in reconstructing Sacre. A reimagining is the creation of a dance for which there exist no reliable sources from which to stage the choreography. Many of Isadora Duncan's dances are, for this reason, reimagined dances. For example, the dance was likely forgotten and not performed for many years, or simply passed down through oral traditions on so many levels that we've lost the general form of the work. Photographs, memoirs, and choreographer's notes may be the only sources from which one can work in a reimagining. The musical score may be the same, and there may be an effort to use costumes and staging that would have been used in the original, but ultimately the choreography is a work in the manner of, rather than a work in imitation of. A selection of additional factors that help the repetiteur to decide upon or determine any one of the above may include the age of the dance, whether the dance is to be reconstructed from primary or secondary sources, or whether they were with or without access to dancers who originally were in the work. Methods used to stage a pre-existing dance are varied in both approach and methodology, but most generally rely upon the memory of the repetiteur as it is informed by earlier performances of the work in which they might have been engaged as a performer. And this, I perceive to be one of the shortcomings in dance reconstruction, or shortcomings or challenges. In dance, the repetiteur's memory of the work often serves as a primary source for restaging and recreation, and thereby grants a degree of authority to the repetiteur that arises in part from his or her generational proximity to the work, that is, to the initial creation, or to another performer who had connection to its initial creation. The reliance upon the repetiteur's memory of the work for its reconstruction, though widely used and accepted in the field of dance, is problematic for a number of reasons. One often overlooked advantage available to dance concerns its relationship with music. The dancer who works from memory has musical cues present in the accompanying musical score, within which movements can be lined up to match with the execution of the work, to fit X number of combinations within so many minutes and seconds of music. The repetiteur merges kinesthetic and oral memory and allows for a reduction of error as dancers place movement with music. This aside, there remain other factors to compromise the process for dances staged wholly from memory. The accepted practice of memory as sole or primary authority tends to comprise much of the canon of the established 19th and 20th century dance masterpieces still in the active repertory, and most of which have relied upon memories of repetiteurs in the reconstruction or restagings. While the notion of memory as authority might occasionally impinge upon lesser-known works, what distinguishes these works from established dance masterpieces is that many lesser-known dances will not be restaged after the death of a choreographer. Should they return to the performance repertory, they will be set either as reconstructions, as in La Sacre, or reimaginings. Take into account that any dance staged by a repetiteur was likely set from memory, perhaps with the assistance of a video or film source, in effect, a dance model of the oral tradition. Clearly the dances are being staged in dance, but what is it we actually see, and how does it compare to the work as envisioned by the choreographer, another step in the lost nature of a work? The fact that we accept the work implies that the methods used to stage the dance are, in fact, effective and successful. So why do I consider methodology based largely on oral traditions as lacking, both in terms of content and authenticity? I do not claim that oral traditions lack integrity or value, but I believe that a complete reliance upon memory will ultimately render a dance as ineffectual. I support retaining oral traditions, but with the support of other resources. It is impossible for all choreographic content in a dance to be relayed intact over the course of generations. Larger choreographic structures will be sustained, but movement and phrasing detail will be impossible to preserve generation upon generation. If, as I have already stated, I am not concerned with fixity in dance, then why should this pose any problem at all? So choreographic fixity, or the quest to set what is believed to be the original staging of the dance, which is what Hodson set out to do in the restaging of Sacre with the help of Marie Rambert. The quest for the original staging is an issue we have to consider. Choreographic structures, as the sum total of the various choreographic phrases that constitute a dance, can exist on both macro levels, understood as the collection of choreographic phrases into large-scale organizational structures of an individual dance, and micro levels, represented as such moment-to-moment details as individual phrases and points of articulation on the body that constitute a perpetual surface of the dance, or excuse me, the perceptual surface of the dance. In my view, the memory of the large-scale macro structure of a dance will tend to be fixed, since any changes at this level will lead to the creation of an entirely new work. For example, Balanchine's use of the score for Stravinsky's violin concerto, first in 1941 as Balustrade, and later as the Stravinsky Violin Concerto from 1972. In this case, the score remained the same for both dances, but the macro structure of the dance was completely different. To the extent to which macro structure is retained over time, we might examine the history of a given dance, where we might find that although a choreographer may choose to alter any number of surface elements of the dance, various movements, steps, or articulations, in the same ways that a performer may choose to play the execution of a particular section of a musical work, by altering its tempo, stresses, etc., the basic structure of the work will be retained. The choreographer and repetiteur may make adjustments to the micro level of the dance simply through the continued refinement of the choreography, but many more changes to the micro level may originate via the ballet master, mistress, and the dancer, whose performance choices may be added to the dance and may have never been approved by the choreographer. Add to this issues of lapses in memory of either the repetiteur or the dancers, and of course the changes in taste and expectation or aesthetics of the practice. For example, in ballet, the expectation and aesthetic is quite different now than it was 20 or even 50 years ago. So presenting a work as it was originally intended 50 years ago would often fall flat with a contemporary audience because the expectation is so different in the current day. The fact remains that dances we see performed on stage represent an amalgam of the creative imagination of the choreographer, as well as the kinesthetic memory of the repetiteur. The late Gordon Belsner, who was the rehearsal and performance pianist and later the musical director for the New York City Ballet from 1959 to 1999, shared with me a valuable philosophy in the process of restaging an existing dance, in which he instructed me that, quote, "The repetiteur responsible for staging one of Balanchine's works is not so much staging Balanchine's choreography as they are staging their personal memory of Balanchine's choreography. so you must acknowledge their memory before you can begin to analyze the correctness or authenticity of the choreography. Balanchine not only expected the dances to change over time, but he also understood that each repetiteur and each dancer would bring their own interpretation to the dance. So though Balanchine may have understood that, I don't know if he would have anticipated that that material would actually be lost in that process. So what we're talking about today is this dance music. Is Sacre, in fact, still lost? You know, Sacre du Printemps is most widely known in its orchestral version and not in the arrangement for piano four hands, as some of you heard this past weekend. Why then did I choose to present the work in concert, not just Sacre, but Apollo, choosing yet another dance score and a piano arrangement? Does this not further separate the score from its missing half, the choreography? To the contrary, I believe that by presenting these works on piano, we can bring the works closer to their original role as works for dance. These arrangements were created by the composer and used in the studio when the dances were originally staged. So in playing them, I believe I'm helping to revive a missing link in the performance practice of the work. The widespread use of recorded music in the staging and rehearsal process has replaced the need for dance musicians for the majority of dance companies, which also makes redundant the need for these arrangements to even exist in the dance setting. By performing these versions of the score, we can bring to today's concert audiences an interpretation that, with the exception of few companies, such as New York City Ballet or ABT or Mark Morris Dance Group, has been replaced by recorded music. As I began to perform dance scores outside of the dance studio and stage, I struggled to understand how or if my playing continued to reflect the nature and quality of the dance, even in the absence of dancers. People who listened to these performances would often remark that in my playing they could see the dance, and I had for some time, admittedly, participated in discussions with dance colleagues on the topic of seeing the music, hearing the dance. Though this topic has received a good deal of traction over the past decades, I found that from my perspective as a performer, it carried as much water as did my cocktail party one-liner that a critic is someone who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. It's a quote I believe I pilfered in my pre-adolescent years from Gary Trudeau, but I've been unable to find where I pilfered it. So upon playing these scores on piano, I'm still trying to find an answer as to why I was, not just why I was doing, but what it represented by playing these works in their original form. I returned to an article I'd read some years ago, Bodily Hearing, Physiological Metaphors and Musical Understanding, written by my friend Dr. Andrew Mead, in which he proposes the theory of kinesthetic empathy. In this article, I was able to find many examples that related to my own experiences in playing for dance. Though Mead designs his theory from the perspective of a music listener or audience member, I found that the role I served as an accompanist or musical repetiteur to dance followed along similar lines, in that I responded not to the text as I would for a singer or notes for an instrumentalist, but to the visual geography created from the choreography. If I was not accompanying the dancers but simply watching them and listening to the music, my sense of the musical score would be shaped by the visual representation of the choreography. But as I was accompanying the dance and later playing these same scores in concert without dance, I came to realize that my musical decisions were based in part on a visual memory of the choreography. There's that problem of memory again. This was not a single memory, but a combination of multiple memories when I consider that I accompanied any given work on multiple dancers, each of whom had their own interpretation of the choreography. Also, in a work such as Sacre, where I've observed multiple choreographies to the score, such as Bausch's, Nijinsky's, Kenneth McMillan, Paul Taylor, and others, the memory of all of these choreographies combined to create a collage of, in Mead's, to quote from Mead, empathetic visual memories that result in a concert interpretation connected not to any one choreographer, but to multiple choreographies. In a work that exists in multiple versions from a single choreographer, such as Balanchine's Apollo or Serenade, where both exist in multiple versions to this day, my memories of different versions coalesce into a musical interpretation that is quite separate from both the dance as well as from a traditional musical interpretation. Though Mead's theory helped to answer for me some of the practices I use as a dance music repetiteur, it could not fully describe the dynamic I experienced, as I was not a listener responding to a musical performance, but rather a musician who made musical choices based on my view of choreographic gesture. I had to embody their responses to the music and preference Cusick's, quote, set of relationships over the, quote, relationship among sounds, end quote, when I took the score out of the dance studio and into the music concert. I did not discard the relationship that exists between me and the dancers, but I further embodied the whole collection of visual kinesthetic memories into a musical performance of the score. So how does this bring us back to Sacre being a lost dance? I propose that actually all dances are lost because once we have viewed them, they are gone. They are part of our memory. And every time we revisit it in our memory, we each have a different view of this work. We cannot go back to that written score for the Beethoven Opus 10 sonatas or the Opus 111 sonatas. We cannot go back to the score of the Tchaikovsky Sixth Symphony, where we can visually have in hand a copy of what this document was. But the memory of the dance gets lost, and every time we revisit it, we attempt to reconstruct it or put back a memory into some other emotion or feeling we had at some time prior. So that is the conclusion for today, and I thank you for listening, and I'd be open to take any questions.